with by Mr. Chintalgiri Shashank from my team at IIT Kanpur. He is stationed in Delhi, and Mr. Neil Ondhia, he is stationed in Kota. They will be helping me in giving some live demonstration from the Modern Coach Factory at Rae Bareli. So I'm going to talk about Industry 4.0. The first couple of slides would be on general history and philosophy, but I will not delve too much into philosophy and come down to brass tacks straight away to discuss what it actually means in terms of implementation. We will then give a short demo where Shashank will take over from me for about 10-15 minutes. Shashank and Neil will take over from me from there, and then they will come back to me, and I will be then talking about an integrated platform for big data, deep learning and machine learning in the Indian Railways, not just relevant for us, but also relevant for the rest of the world. Okay. So as I said, we will be talking in the context of the project that we have launched at the Modern Coach Factory at Rae Bareli, and it deals with Industry 4.0, application of these protocols to rail coach design and manufacturing. So, by way of context and background, Mr. Ajay Nandan is very well aware and has been an active motive power behind introduction of this concept at the Modern Coach Factory at Rae Bareli. So it was till a couple of years ago producing about 500 coaches per year. And they were able to increase that by 3 or 4 times. That is up to, say, 1,000, 1,200 coaches per year by bits and pieces applications of Industry 4.0 principles without too much of investment in the infrastructure. Industry 4.0, by the way, is all about optimum utilization of our capacity, optimum utilization of assets without any additional investment into infrastructure. That is the primary goal of Industry 4.0. So our Honorable Prime Minister inspected MCF in 2018 and provided the necessary impetus and inspiration for this initiative, where he made an announcement that MCF should increase the capability and capacity to 5,000 coaches per year and its proliferation in railway units across India. How much of it is feasible and viable? But we definitely see that with proper implementation, we should be able to touch about 3,000 coaches per annum without too much of investment and restructuring in the infrastructure and setup. Once it is successful, it is also useful for other government units like defense production and the private sector. And one fallout recently over the past one month has been that we have been now approached by the Ministry of MSME for looking at possible implementation of the kind of prototypes that we have developed at MCF Rae Bareli for implementation in the MSME clusters. There are about 350 such clusters in the country. Leather cluster, lock cluster, coir cluster, carpet cluster, etc., which are much more rudimentary than what railways is. But if we are able to introduce this Industry 4.0 in MSME, it will have a transformative effect. And that is one of the byproducts of the current activity that we have undertaken. So the objective is to develop Industry 4.0 protocols for rail and coach design and manufacturing for improved productivity and process flexibilities. The money is not too much, but when you grow technology in your own backyard, it doesn't cost much. It is the total outlay is about 16 crores, and the money has been provided by the Ministry of Science and Technology. The railways has its own share of about 42 crores, which it has already invested in terms of infrastructure, networking, software, etc. We are about 1 year into this project. Let's first see what is this all this jargon about Industry 4.0. Now, Industry 1.0, as we have started calling it, refers to the first industrial revolution. This took place in the year or in the time zone around 1760 to 1840. This is the time when Emperor Shah Alam was on the throne of Delhi, and he was fighting the East India Company in the Battle of Buxar and eventually lost it. It was at this time that James Watt was born in the UK, Britain, and invented the first steam engine. Steam engine made a very important contribution in the development of humankind, that it was probably the first energy conversion device. Prior to this industrial revolution, motion or motive power was all generated by either human beings or animals, by utilizing human power or by utilizing animal power. This was the first energy conversion device where heat was converted into motion. And it had a historical transformative effect, that you start converting heat, first you generate heat, and then convert heat into motion. It had consequences on textile manufacturing, iron industry, agriculture, and mining, which till now depended on human and biological transformation of energy to motive power, was shifted to steam. The second industrial revolution concerned itself with the invention of electricity. Thomas Alva Edison, from 1870 to 1914. This largely took place in the United States, where electricity, generation of electricity, started revolutionizing communication and also faster transfer of people and ideas. It allowed factory electrification and electrification of the production line. This was the early part of the previous century, before the First World War. The third industrial revolution, which is as it is now called, is also called the digital revolution, and it started with the first Z1 electrically driven mechanical calculator, and then the invention of computers and the proliferation its usage in communication technologies, and also the development of the supercomputer. This categorization also, people started talking about this categorization when they wanted to introduce another concept, And this happened in a meeting in the trade meeting, the large meeting like the InnoTrans in Hanover. So it was in the Hanover Messe in 2011 that the word Industry 4.0 was first talked about. And it promotes computerization of manufacturing, strong customization of products under conditions of highly flexible mass production, introduction of self-optimization, self-configuration, self-diagnosis, cognition, and intelligent support of workers. And the prime technology behind this is the Internet of Things. We had human beings interacting with each other over the internet. Human to human talk over the internet. We then had human to machine talk over the internet. The first one was Internet of Human Beings. When humans are talking with machines, it is human to thing internet. And when a thing starts talking to a thing like a machine one talking starts talking to a machine two, it becomes Internet of Things. So it is Internet of Things where which involves sensorization, which involves digitization, communication of data, building of analytics on the basis of the data that is being collected. And whatever analytics that you wish to build upon that is all structured, is a superstructure based on the infrastructure of Internet of Things. And it can be utilized in, once you have the data, you can utilize it in whichever possible way that you think possible. So four design principles. So this is how the development of technology to Industry 4.0 has been predicted. Now, whether it is Indian Railways or the general Indian scenario of infrastructure, if things start talking to things, also if human beings start talking to things through controllers and through other devices, and then we have built the infrastructure for Industry 4.0. It is available to us. We have done that again in bits and pieces, in a scattered, isolated manner in various sectors across the country, including the railways. The task is to integrate all of this and to bring it on a meaningful platform so that data can be available to where it should be available. And then we build the necessary analytics on top of that. So four design principles of Industry 4.0 are interconnection, which I've already talked about, machines, devices, sensors, and people to connect to each other. Transparency of information. And this is very critical. Once information becomes transparent on how many machines are active and how many machines are not active, what shop is active and to what extent it is active, what sector is active and what not active, what are the bottlenecks, what are the drawbacks. If this information is transparent, that itself will go a long way in improving our overall utilization of assets. Technical assistance, which can be provided by the internet, it results in a large-scale democratization of the whole process of production and the process management, and decentralized decisions. So these are the four design principles of Industry 4.0. It also, implementation of Industry 4.0 also fits well with the National Manufacturing Policy, which says that manufacturing should constitute at least 25% of the GDP. And it is obviously very, very low in terms of its contribution to India's GDP today. And this initiative, which has been taken by the Indian Railways through the Technology Mission, will obviously be a pilot for for many, many sectors to follow. The technology domains, as I said, is it involves many, many areas, which you can see here. Internet of Things, cloud computing, component system design, dynamics, manufacturing process, controls, sensors, data acquisition, signal processing. And all of us engineers know about all these things. It's a question of putting all of it together, neural networks, multi-objective optimization, fuzzy logic, etc. Putting it on a platform, integrated platform is what is required. So we are talking about a platform, which is where all these, which is the confluence of all these technologies. Also RAMs. So the shell shop is what is chosen at MCF for implementation. This is a highly congested and compressed drawing of the shop floor. You see on the right-hand side, the shop floor is for the shell shop. The sheet metal enters on the right-hand side. It goes from right to left, not left to right. Right to left like Urdu. So sheet metal enters on the right-hand side and exits on the left in the form of a shell. You would have about 50 to 60 different types of machines on or manufacturing stations on this shop. And as you are better aware than me, probably each coach has 1300 to 1400 different components. And the shop has at any instant of time material for about 25 coaches scattered at various points. So there is material flow which is taking place in a very, very dynamic manner, and which currently is only the person who is handling it knows what he is doing, probably. So, are you with me? One of you can tell me, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So this is what the picture looks like on the shell shop. It has side walls, it has end walls, roof fabrication and underframe fabrication. I am not a railway person, so please pardon my lack of knowledge about railways. I am still trying to learn it, though I've been with the railways for the last 20 years. But pardon me if there is any lapse on my informational part. So, so these are the pictures of fabrication of roof, fabrication of underframe, with at various points. Some of it is automated. Most of the machines are not automated, as we will see in the coming few slides. So these pictures serve to show what the system actually is. If you look at the current system, we have in the center production engineering based on production machine. You have quality assurance systems, product app design applications, you have production planning software, and there is an accounting and finance module, purchase module, sales and services module, and HR personnel module. Some of them is in soft form, some of them is in hard form. But as you see these statements that I have made, that there is no interaction between one activity and the other activity. It is either human, which becomes very, very subjective, It depends on how much can be done, and places where there are no interactions whatsoever. The state of technology today offers us an option of, and also let me come to machines. You have machines, different types of machines on the shop floor. There are robots. The brown ones that you see are typical machines. Brown ones are machines with FANU controllers. The blue one is with Siemens controller. And the black box is machines which do not talk at all, which do not have any control system at all. Now, these FANUC machines have their own controller and they keep the controller within themselves. Siemens machines have a controller and which remains confined to the Siemens machines. There is no connectivity between these individual machines. While there is an Ethernet facility which runs throughout the factory, the FANUC machines that you see talk to a vendor-supplied software, and the vendor keeps the software to himself, and it just displays some of the final results in terms of availability of these machines, whether they are functioning or not functioning, in the form of a dashboard without sharing any actual data, with very, very partial functionality, and does not allow any further functionalities to be built on the data that is being connected. The question is, how do you do machine data aggregation, which is the primary requirement? How do you take the data from the vendor platform to an aggregator platform that you and I can possibly develop, or somebody else develops it for us, and unless the vendor allows it? What do we do with Siemens machines or with Heidenheim machines or any other machines with where we don't even have a vendor? And then once the data is there, you have a bigger question: what do you do with the data, and how do you utilize it for your scheduling of the processes, for monitoring of machine conditions, so that you can take a predictive data maintenance? How do you assure this data to help you in quality control? And if there is data on material tracking, like from RFID tags, if there is data from event detection through some tracking stations, how do you integrate all of them, do machine monitoring, and build analytics for further action, like scheduling? And these are questions that need to be tackled. And these are questions which can be answered only through hard work at the shop floor level. For example, these are the kinds of machines on the shell shop. You have robotic workstations, robots, with different types of controllers, HMIs, manual workstation, total number of workstations. So this is 42, last column, last row, 42 workstations. Then the design and planning activity has CAD simulation, CAM simulation, and different softwares like Unigraphics and MT-Link-I, which remain within the computers on which they are installed. Uh, What is desired? Desired is an integrated platform like this, where in the green box, you see real-time monitoring of machines. What currently exists is what you see in gray. You have the NX center, you have the team center, which is then giving you the product list and a production plan, which is provided. And these boxes are there. All of them have to be integrated in a scheduling software platform that one needs to create for capacity scheduling, to do make and buy decisions, to do the buy list, to do scheduling based on artificial intelligence, and also do machine and work center loading plan in a real-time basis from the real-time data that comes from the integrated hardware platform that we're talking about. And all of this should be available at the management level dashboard. Whether this dashboard is in Raebareli or at RDSO or at the level of the board, at all levels, this dashboard, right from the board level to the person operating the machine, there have to be dashboards at every level for display and monitoring and control of activities. It's a humongous task. This is what the infrastructure already is in terms of the optical fiber connectivity. And obviously, this infrastructure is not utilized to its fullest, because we are really not, while the machines are connected, most of them, but either the machines are not talking through these connections. If they are talking, one doesn't know what to do with the data. So the overall Industry 4.0 solution looks like this, and we will also demonstrate what has been done. You have the physical world of machines, sensors, RFIDs, HMIs, etc. Build a data acquisition layer, which is quite generic in nature. And these are various plug-and-play modules. You do data integration and event detection. This is passed on to long-term storage of time series data, depending on how much would one like to store this. And this is what this structure is not just specific to a manufacturing production unit. It would be equally relevant for asset management and scheduling related activity of timetables, railway timetables, dashboards, integration of existing ERP, CRM, and inventory systems, which will contribute their own information, and build those protocol adapters to connect them to what the data is coming from below, and generate a schedule which is then these are the details which I will skip for the moment. So this is the overall structure that looks like, which finally takes us to analytics and model training through in the future through deep learning activities. Okay. So if you take these as two primary blocks, one is real-time monitoring on the shop floor, and then there is a scheduler that we have finally come up with. We have come up till now, we have achieved the real-time monitoring of the system. We are working on the scheduler, but the scheduler requires a lot of data. The scheduler requires production plan, production orders, PSL for not just one variant of the coach. You have more than two dozen or three dozen variants of different types of coaches. all that data in terms of their individual components, subsystems, and systemic level needs to be entered even for MCF, which will go to the scheduler. On basis of that, you have, any questions? All right. The scheduler, through the production schedule, allows you to take, make, or buy decisions. If buy decision is taken, then indents should be generated, demand authorization has to take place, and items which are purchased, all this happens in the purchase and stores. On the make part, it has to generate work orders for individual specific subsystems and also at the machine level. And the purchased item information has to go from the other unit and work on status. And all of this has to talk to the real-time monitoring system, which gives a feedback to the scheduler for the process of learning and optimization, of dynamic optimization. This should happen if it is if we are able to implement it successfully. This is the goal, and then the rest of the activity. Within machine monitoring itself, that one single block, what has been done is through our own indigenously built software, we have taken the FANUC robots and FANUC CNC machines through proprietary software of MT FANUC itself, which comes with the machines. And we have to utilize these add-ons which come with the machine. Sometimes they are not utilized, and sometimes the vendors are very clever. They do not give us these add-ons. And only now do we realize that some of these add-ons are missing. They have not been supplied at all. If they were supplied, then they are not being utilized. So we need to insist in any future procurement that these modules which come from the individual machines should be available for us to make them talk to our systems. Then this NIOPC server that you see for Siemens machines, this has been designed by us. This has been designed by us. And then manual machines, there are a large number of these manual machines, as you see, 15 of them. We have built data acquisition systems and sensorized them to come up with an indigenously built module. And then all of this data gets aggregated in a form, identical form, which can be processed. We will show you how it gets displayed and how do we process it. And then the top arrow that you see, orange arrow that you see coming from the left side to material tracking, that is from RFID tracking stations. So these also have been installed. Tracking stations, a couple of them have been installed, and the RFID tracking has also been checked and validated on the same machine aggregator platform. There are no imported solutions available for this. Even trying out, as I'll show you in one of the slides. Other monitoring approaches. I would not like to go into the details of it is not that if as if we wanted to invent all the wheels ab initio and did not want to use the wheels that were already available. It is just that the wheels that are available either do not fit our tracks and do not fit our rolling stock. It is as simple as that. We have to design our own systems. They have a few platforms which are prohibitively expensive. In this project, though the project is overall cost was 17 crores, we've been able to do this import substitution and indigenously build software just for about 2.5 crores, where most of the money has gone into salaries of our own engineers and software. So it's like making jalebi at home rather than buying it from the market. And once you learn how to make your own jalebis, you can make all sorts of things. So this is what the digital twin of the plant looks like. The sheet metal enters from the right hand side. I will, and the colors that you see for various blocks are workstations. The orange ones are Fanuc workstations. The yellow ones are Fanuc robots. There are Siemens machines. There are machines which do not did not talk. And I will now pass you over to Shashank or Neil to give you a live demo of the data that is being acquired, currently being acquired at the server in MCF. And I will also ask them to spend about 10-15 minutes on the individual codes. And then I'll come back to big data and deep learning. Yes.
Okay. Yes, sir. Good morning. So what we're seeing on the screen at present is the live dashboard from MCF. We are using AnyDesk.
Are you sharing it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir. The screen is visible.
Is Shashank
at DAQ panel? DAQ panel is visible, sir.
Yes, so,
okay, I am not able to see it. Shashank?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you continue. Though I am not able to see it, you continue.
Okay. So what we are seeing is the live data from MCF. At present, we are collecting collecting data from a number of robotic and CNC machines from Shell Shop in MCF. So what we see is what you see on the screen is a representation of the blocks that Dr. Vyas had showed just now of the overall layout of Shell Shop. So this is what we call a 2D digital twin. It's not a full digital twin. A full digital twin does not give us sufficiently enough advantage to go for the effort required to construct it. On the other hand, the two-dimensional digital twin is something that is required to understand materials flow and to monitor data in a manner that gives us some useful input for scheduling. So as he had showed just now, if we just take a moment, the 2D digital twin basically is showing us a number of lines, each of the workstations. So a robotic machine, a CNC machine, or a manual workstation are all places where certain operations take place. Materials flow through these machines, materials flow through these workstations and get processed through the workstations. So knowing the layout is important to be able to schedule the operations, to be able to schedule material transport through this process. So what we have done and we are in the process of doing is what we are in the process of doing at present is understanding the process flow through the various operations. So what we are seeing here in yellow is essentially the machines from the 2D digital twin for these yellow machines here. These are the machines, some robotic, some CNC, some manual, that are involved in the manufacture of the sidewall left side. So as he had mentioned, the raw materials enter from the right side of this diagram. They pass through various workstations, and the operations happening at each of these workstations result in a completed sidewall left-hand side on the left side of this.
Let me just butt in at this moment. As you can see, the yellow blocks are the ones which are the green one is the one which is operational in the automated mode. The yellow ones are the ones which are operational but in manual mode. While our platform is connected to all the machines that you see here. Okay. Just the transparency and the availability of this data shows that what is the level of utilization of the infrastructure and the machinery. I would leave it at this point and again pass it over to Shashank.
Yes. So as he has mentioned, what we see here is what you see on the top half of the screen is a live representation of the same diagram which I was talking about previously. This sidewall left side is basically these machines in this region, if you're able to see my mouse. Mm-hmm. So what we are now interested in...
Not visible. Yes.
Okay. All right. In the second row from the top, what you see, the machines that are there in a similar layout.
Mr. Shashank, your screen is not being shared. We are only seeing you.
Screen sharing has.
Sorry. One second.
Now it's visible.
Let's turn this off. Yes. So this was the 2D digital twin, which is essentially the plant layout. So what we are seeing on this dashboard, which is a live representation of that same diagram, is the various workstations and their current live status. So as sir was saying, the yellow machines are those that are operating in manual mode or that are idle. So basically these machines are either in some kind of a jog state or some kind of manual operation happening. The green machine is something that is operating in the normal mode, the automated mode. So there probably some manufacturing is going on. The pink are machines which are currently giving an emergency signal. The gray machines are currently off. So what we see, what we get using this this data and this platform that we're working on is the live status of all the machines. So Shell Shop is the one for which we
and
have.
And on the left hand side, you see the RFID event tracking. You have two tracking stations that you would see in orange color, two or three tracking stations that you see a component has entered has passed through a particular tracking station, and it is being processed there, and other one coming out. So, the RFID event tracking is also taking place on the same dashboard. So you have the status history, which is. You have the machine status as well as the RFID event tracking, which will then be mapped onto an ideal or optimized schedule that Shashank is not now going to talk about. Go ahead, Shashank.
Yes. So. Right. So as he has mentioned, we are now tracking the status history. We are tracking material movement, or at least in the pilot phase. That at present we are tracking some materials in some regions. The idea is that by tracking material movement through the plant floor, we are able to get by tracking a combination of material movement as well as machine status through the plant floor. Through the shop floor, we are able to get a picture of the sequence of operations and the time it takes to perform the assembly, the manufacture of the shell. So this is based on data that we get from MCF, a lot of manual data that we are gathering and developing in collaboration with MCF. As well as our software, which we'll talk about briefly. This is a highly data-driven endeavor. A lot of raw data has to come in. A lot of information has to be obtained from the plant, from design, information about the product structure list. The materials on the shop floor are tagged with RFID tags or to be tagged with RFID tags so that we can monitor the movement through the shop floor. So that is what gives us some insight into how the plant floor is laid out and how materials move.
Yeah. Next slide, please.
Yes, sir. So in order to do scheduling, this process flow information is critical. At present, most of this process flow information is coming through discussion. So, for example, what we find is that the best way to get the process flow information is to talk to the people at the workstations, talk to the people at and near the workstations. The farther away we go from the workstation, the less clarity there is on what is the specific sequence of operations, how long each operation takes, what are the inputs, outputs, how many operators are needed, so on and so forth. So most of this information is actually coming from there. So at present, what we have been able to achieve is monitoring of all automated machines in Shell Shop, which was previously done using the Zifra-based monitoring system. We are now fully replaced with alternate solutions, which give us the advantage that this data is now accessible to us. So with the system that was previously being used, although the data was being collected, the data was not accessible. So we could not, for example, store long-term history, use that long-term history for analytics, for training AI models, things like that. But at present, now we have full control over the data that we're acquiring from the machines. We're able to store them, we're able to process them. All of this data, as he has mentioned, is also combined with RFID and material flow tracking. So monitoring the machines is only one half of the story. We are able to, for example, say which machine was on for what period. But that data has to be coupled with the flow of materials to the plant to give us useful information. So for this purpose, we're using RFID tags to track the flow of material through the production line. So this is something that we're currently working on. The basic principle is that the larger components, for example, the sidewall sheets, things like that, are tagged, and we're able to monitor as they pass through each of their workstations. We're able to see, we would like, using this system, we would like to be able to see the amount of time it takes, it spends at each workstation. Once we couple that with the machine operational status, we can figure out, for example, how much time has been spent in setup, in teardown, and in other operations, which reduce the overall throughput of the line.
Shashank, slightly faster.
Yes. So for material tracking, we have RFID tags. RFID readers are tracking stations. Are being installed in the factory. We are trying out different RFID readers to figure out which will have the best range and best function in that kind of environment. All of these RFID tracking data is passing through an RFID middleware and coming into a material tracking system. So if I go back to the dashboard for a moment, you'll see on the left side bottom corner, RFID event tracking. So the on various RFID tracking stations, you see certain timestamps and an RFID tag ID that is shown. So this basically is, as the materials pass near one of our tracking stations, we are able to take a picture of when that tag previously passed through it. At present, this is in somewhat early stages, but yes. So this, I think, so in order to make sense of the material tracking, so this is the same picture with a little bit more detail. We'll skip through most of it, but the same in order to make sense of the material tracking, the critical data inputs are understanding the plant layout and the tracking station locations, and having a part numbering and identification system. So for example, when we place an RFID tag on a part, we need to be able to recognize what that part is, which lot it's from, what's the part number, and so on. So those are the critical inputs needed in order to ensure that this RFID subsystem is giving us useful data. So this is the prototype dashboard that we currently have. So as he had mentioned, there are a lot of other software that we are using which are able to give us the data. So for Siemens machines, we are using NIOPC servers, which allows us access to Siemens machines. This is all done using LabVIEW code. What you can see here is basically graphical source code, which allows us to connect to NIOPC servers, get the tag value, and perform a little bit of logic on the tag value to determine what the actual state of the machine is. This is, Similarly for FANUC, we are using FANUC's own MT-Link-I software. This is something that, as he had mentioned, was not included with the machines. It is something that we procured from FANUC, which again connects to FANUC CNC machines and FANUC robots. Using this software, we can get data for certain tags, most tags from the machine. All of this data is acquired again using NI graphical code over a HTTP REST API. And again, we are able to perform a little bit of logic on the tag data that we're getting from the software, to determine what the actual state of the machine is and sort of whether it's operating, whether it's not operating. In the case of some machines, for example, we can get things like part numbers.
Skip through the details, Shashank. Just to mention that all these codes have been built jointly by the IIT Kanpur team and the MCF team. So the codes are our own codes, where by we are interrogating each of these machines ourselves through a code that is written by us, and the raw data is available. Yeah, quickly scheduling now.
Yes. So the sort of more important and critical item is scheduling. The machine monitoring is giving us data, but scheduling is what we want to do, and that's what the scheduling the machine monitoring is, so that we can do scheduling. This is the overall scheduling process. There is, you have various pieces of data, the PSL, the production plan, resource availability, stock status, and so on, which can be used to generate a preliminary production plan, as in the previous diagram, the initial diagram which sir had shown. From the preliminary production plan, we generate, obtain a buy list as well as an actual production plan, which includes, say, workstation loading charts and so on. The buy list passes through IMMS, which is the ERP system that is currently being used to produce to trigger a purchase, essentially. The IMMS can also provide us information about the current PO status. And as the production schedule, the production plan is executed on the shop floor, the various feedback synthesis is coming from machine status monitoring as well as monitoring tracking so that we can constantly update the schedule. So the production plan is sort of a ideal workstation loading chart an ideal sequence of operations. But as we get real-time data from the shop floor, we can update the schedule in real-time and reschedule it. And also, this data over a period of time can be used to improve our estimates of how long each operation should take, and also identify bottlenecks. So the scheduler we're using is an open source scheduler called Freppl, which we've been working with now for some time. The details, I think we can probably gloss over a little bit. But the basic idea is that we have spent a fair amount of time talking to a large number of vendors, including Optessa, Datasort, and so on. Each of these vendors, although they have a fairly elaborate scheduling product, the scheduling product is only as good as the data that you can provide to the scheduling product. So, for example, you need a sequence of operations from for the production. You need the machine data. You need plant layouts. You need the PERT chart showing how long each step takes. If that data cannot be provided to any vendor, although their software has a lot of features and is fairly expensive, without that data, no one is able to do any kind of scheduling. Additionally, most of these softwares are based on skilled manpower that is not here. So, for example, the Salt would provide manpower from a different country in order to integrate their system with MCF, with MCF's data. And so we've had a lot of trouble working with
what happens is that the data all goes to Malaysia, and there's a girl, because the vendors sitting in India, they are most of them are salesmen. They don't do the coding, and they don't do the software implementation also. So the data goes to, as we have seen during our discussions, there's a girl sitting in Indonesia or Malaysia who is looking at all the data, and then would, if they at all are able to develop this platform, would then be controlling what we should buy and what we should make, how much we should make and how much we should not make, so what machines we should make and what we should buy additionally. So the control of all our manufacturing activities, the decision making is passed over to the hands of the vendor who's supplied the software platform. So that is a very, very big question that we need to answer before adopting any kind of platform for automation of services and monitoring of any of our assets. The control, especially in this case, the data belongs to the Indian Railways. It has to remain with the Indian Railways. It has to be made available to the Indian Railways, and the control should remain in the hands of Indian Railways. And likewise for the defense sector and for the MSME sector. The control and the data is ours. Data is the power. Data is the wealth. No one should be able to then dictate to us 10 years from now what we are going to do. Not 10 years, even 10 months from now, what we should do. Yes, Shashank. Yes. Please conclude in 5 minutes so that I can spend some time on deep learning and machine learning.
Yes. So in collaboration with MCF, we have identified that these are some of the critical data points that are required to do successful scheduling. So what you see in the inner blue box, this inside this border, are items from the software. So either the software itself or parts that we are developing. Now, in order to sufficiently feed this platform so that we get useful information, we need all the things that are on the outside. So if we start from the top left, the first item that you need is infrastructure. That means an understanding of workstation and plant layouts, manpower availability, and the lists of all the machines. And then you, on top of the infrastructure data, you have something called the production model, which basically tells you if you have to make a certain variant of the coach, what operations, what sequence of operations do you need to do in order to successfully produce that coach. So that so the production model is composed of operation details, PERT charts, which basically show us how long each step takes, what are the series of steps and how long each step takes for the manufacturing, and the PSL, which is the product structure list. On the right hand side, you see the data that's coming from stores and purchase. So basically this is to happen through integration with IMMS or existing platforms. So for purchasing, we have to get data for who your vendors are, what the alternate sourcing paths are. So for example, you can either manufacture a sidewall or you can buy the sidewall from three or four different vendors. Each of these vendors will have a certain cost. They'll have a certain turnaround time, lead time for purchase and so on. So when, in order to make an effective schedule, all of this data has to be provided to the system. Similarly, you need the inventory ERP, the data of what is currently present in the shop or in your stores to identify which item can you simply take out of your store versus an item that you have to make or buy. The overall flow of the scheduling is actually from top to bottom. The transient scheduling input is the plant order stream. So a series of orders that are coming through the plant. So there are 10 coaches of this kind or 5 coaches of that kind or 20 coaches of some other kind. From the plant order stream, the scheduling platform is able to use all of this data coming in from the left and the right to produce the data that's shown at the bottom. That is a series of work orders, a series of material handling orders, so purchase orders, transfer orders and things like that. So this is essentially the shape of a scheduler scheduling system. So we'll skip this. So yeah, so this is an example for example of 10 sidewall left hand sides. In order to manufacture sidewall left hand side, you have a various operations that are happening. So this third column of resource that you see is basically the workstation. So this operation is happening at that. The what you see on the right side is a Gantt chart of the operations. This is essentially, in some sense, a workstation loading chart. So what we are able to model in this way is if you want to manufacture 10 sidewalls, which machines are involved, how much time is used in at each machine. This is again based on data that is taken from MCF in collaboration with them. So we can also identify, for example, that the second operation that we're seeing, SWL roof bearer robotic MIG welding, is scheduled the bottleneck. That is where the machine is fully occupied. These shorter lines that you see, the almost vertical lines, are the transport orders. So these are basically the time that we have modeled to show how long it takes for a part to move from one workstation to the next workstation. So in these transport orders, we are also, for example, constraining how many cranes are available. So as what we see is that as you, if you are trying to make a single sidewall, it takes a fairly large number of hours, about 21 hours or so. However, as you increase the order size, as you go to about 10 or so order, 10 or so sidewalls, you start to reach convergence in the time taken per sidewall, average time taken per sidewall. This happens because the sidewall manufacturing process, as are most manufacturing processes, a pipeline process. We have a number of machines. So if we are making a certain number of sidewalls, we are making effective use of our production capacity. If we were to constantly switch, say, from one variant to another variant to another variant, the setup time and the scheduling overheads will make our plant inefficient. So this process allows us to identify, for example, ideal lot sizes to ensure effective capacity utilization. So I think we can maybe skip through the dashboard designs, and so you can.
Okay. What is being planned is dashboard, the overall dashboard and the dashboards which are which should be available from top to bottom. Just spend 2 minutes on this and then.
Yes. So what we're working on is a series of dashboards. The dashboard that we had shown you is the one that's currently on screen. This is a shop floor monitoring dashboard. Similarly, a large number of dashboards are currently being developed. So they're in early stages of development that show different kinds of information. So on the shop floor monitoring dashboard, we have already spent some time on it. But the basic idea is that there's a 2D digital twin of the shop floor, which is showing live status. We're seeing RFID tracking history, and we're seeing recent alarms and emergency events. In addition, when we hover on one of the machine blocks, what we are expecting to see, although it's currently still in development, is show what operation is currently going on, what are the components that are physically present at the workstation. Similarly, if we hover over a RFID tracking station, we want to be able to see the RFID tracking history at this station. When we click on one of the machines, we want to go to a machine specific dashboard. Once we go to the machine specific dashboard, what we will be seeing is a live status and the status history, any machine operational parameters that are identified that we want to look at. But from a scheduling perspective, what we are currently focused on is the list of recent operations at this machine. So what was the operation? What was the part number? What was the name of the operator? Things like that. List of recent RFID tracking events and list of recent downtimes. And in addition to that, for this machine, we also want to show list of all possible operations that are associated with this machine in the model. So you could be doing, for example.
I think now you've given a fair idea. We would like to talk a little bit about deep learning now, and then
yes,
have about 10-15 minutes for any interaction that they would like to have.
Yes. So there are a large, yes, I'll just take about 30 seconds and just skip through the rest of it. So we have the RFID tracking dashboard. Similarly, we have a dashboard for monitoring of operations. So list of active orders, active operations, which machines are being used, how long each operation has taken. For each sales order, which is essentially a production order, we want to monitor percentage completion. What is the status? Is it on time or delayed? What are the components? Which components are done? Which are not done? For each component, similarly, you have what's the serial number, why is it being manufactured, what are the processes required, how many of these processes are done, not done, so on. So being able to show all of this data gives us the transparency we need to make decisions for the shop floor, and gives us a bird's eye view of the flow of manufacturing and the capacity utilization, which is what we are currently targeting as the area wherein we can improve productivity by better utilizing capacity. So, sir, would you like to take over?
Yes. Do we have time? Can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Yes, sir. We have a lot of time, sir.
Can I share my screen now?
Yes, I think you can just share it. I will stop.
Do you see it?
Yes, sir. Plant layout, it's visible.
Yeah. So most of it has been talked about by Shashank. What remains to be done is implementation in this particular shop over a period of next 2 to 3 months, and then scaling it up to the factory level. And this is the scale-up diagram. Now I will just talk a little bit about an railway asset management system that we've been talking at the international level in several of the conferences in Europe and in Southeast Asia on having an integrated platform for railway asset management, which is data-driven and utilizes the latest techniques of machine learning and artificial intelligence. So it draws its inspiration from the aerospace integrated vehicle health management program of NASA. And we had adopted this for the light combat aircraft that has been launched by the government, and HAL has been placed with a very, very big revolutionary order for manufacturing of the light combat aircraft. This is for the Mark II of, presently we are in Mark I, for the Mark II development is taking place, and it is along the lines of NASA Integrated Vehicle Health Management Program. There are different levels of technology development. The lowest level is development of sensors, and you can see parallels in the railways as well, which I will highlight in a couple of slides. You have the lowest level of technology development of sensorization, modeling and simulation, developing models and simulation, and data analysis, and there's something which is hidden, and then development of test beds as well, which is very important for indigenous development of technologies. And the light combat aircraft and also the automotive domain has several such test beds within the country. At each of this technology level of development leads to the second level of development, where we have the inputs from each of these elements at the lower level into the various subsystems of an air vehicle. Like you have the airframe, you would have avionics, you would have the propulsion system where you have the turbines, you have the landing gear, and so forth, so on and so forth. In the railways, it would be bogies, and it would be coaches and wagons and locomotives and motive power, and the subsystems that you would like to have here. This is the health management level of the at the subsystemic level. And each of these lower elements feeding into the subsystemic level. And at the vehicular, at the subsystemic level, which takes us on to the vehicular level, we do, based on data, we do detection of anomalies, detection of problems, like you may have broken rails, broken springs, bearing seizures, hot boxes, hot wheels, etc. Diagnosis, prognosis, mitigation, and integrity assurance. And this then takes us to the vehicular level, and at the systemic or the fleet level of intelligence. In aerospace, we are currently, the state of our technology is between level 2 and level 3. There is, say, these are the aero subsystems that you see: hydraulic and landing gear system, engine management and environmental control, electrical system, fuel system, beams, and so on and so forth. Similarly, there is, you would see a lot of similarity between an automotive IVHF, and most of the companies worth their salt in the world have incorporated in a big way automotive integrated vehicle health management, like the aircraft in an automotive. You would have the powertrain, the chassis, et cetera, et cetera. And you would these days have at least 4 kilometers of wiring within a normal passenger family car, is what we have today. So automotive system health management involves all these things, building of models, neural networks, data collection, data analysis, and building of neural networks and fuzzy logic systems, which we have been doing for the automotive sector and the aerospace sector, various components of health management. Railways is a bigger system of systems, and people are talking these days about how do you manage systems, a system of systems. You have the this is what from an international point of view this has been drawn. You have all these subsystems. Indian Railways has a slightly different set of subsystems, bogies, axles, wheels, rails, and we have tracks and bridges, we have rolling stock, we have signaling and telecom, and so on and so forth. So these are the subsystems which all integrate and work together and contribute to the operation of the entire system. Each of these subsystems, and they all interact with each other in a myriad of different ways. The rolling stock management system that we have involves all these things. Okay. And that track management system, which I know is operational at the board level, has different types of inputs, which are one-time inputs, periodic inputs, inspection reports, and outputs, which are mostly in the form of displays at the moment, are master asset-related, inspection-related, and you would be probably better aware of these outputs that are available for the track management system. Similarly, you have the subsystem for signaling management. Scheduling is a big exercise that we have been discussing with TCS for a very long time at the R&D level. That if you see here, this is the map of the Kanpur railway station, where you have 10 platforms and they are being fed by 32 lines at the top. And these are the 10 different platforms in a zoom picture. We have 250 trains coming from one side and going to the other side, and 250 trains coming from the other side going to the other way around in 24 hours. Here you have the kind of scheduling that you are doing. You are doing 17 different types of scheduling: driver scheduling, signal scheduling, rate scheduling, maintenance scheduling, so on and so forth. It is a humongous task. If all of it were to be digitized and automated on a nationwide scale, it is a very, very gigantic task, and TCS has been involved to some extent, and the Observer Research Foundation in Bombay also had done this exercise for what is it called, Bombay Suburban Railways, where they optimized the scheduling. Did an exercise and projected that we could increase the number of trains with the existing infrastructure by 160, with 6,000 additional kilometers of running by adjustment in timetables alone, without any. And this has been carried out under the supervision of Mr. Vivek Sahai. I think former chairman, railway board, or member, rolling stock. This is data from Smart Passenger Coach. What is being proposed at the international level is a deep learning protocol for integrated rail system management, which aims to develop an open software platform for knowledge extraction, automated detection, diagnosis, prognosis, and decision making to enable to improve the overall efficiency and safety of the railway system. So the configuration is that it's a deep learning open platform starting at the component level, which may be frames, bearings, bolsters. We're talking of a platform development. Analytics will be separate, but this is the platform, what the platform would look like. And then at the subsystem level, subsystemic ring, engine, wagon, coaches, signals, etc., etc. And then the vehicular level, operational parameters, and then infrastructural issues and organizational goals. The overall configuration is of the platform currently is envisaged like this. And each of these concentric rings that you break, that you see, are not planar. It's not a planar structure, but each of these rings breaks out in a number of such rings which are parallel to each other and concentric to each other. And data flows between from one ring to another ring and at the same level and at higher levels, just a moment, in a variety of ways. So it's like a multi-limbed octopus which keeps growing with time and with data. You have a huge amount of data, and what do you do with, how do you compress that data? And it is here that we develop a deep learning convolution-based neural network. This slide shows you how it is done through several layers of convolution. You have data coming from shafts, gears, and bearings. For a typical turbo machine, this example is for a turbo machine, and through several stages of this conversion, this you will see that the data gets compressed, converted into a very small nugget, which contains all the information about the signal and also leads us to the condition of the entire subsystem, which has shaft, gearing, bearing, etc. This has been successfully implemented for various gas turbines and power propulsion systems all over the world. To end with just a few pictures of the previous mission, this was not necessary, but has come in from the other presentation at the railway board. I'll skip this. Finally, this technology mission for Indian Railways is a consortium of the Ministry of Railways, Ministry of Human Resource Development, and the Ministry of Science and Technology, an investment sharing model. And the focus is to take up R&D projects in the area of safety, heavy haul, high speed, metro rail, and energy and environment. Thank you. I thought there was one more. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful and an exhaustive presentation, which covered all the aspects of Industry 4.0 and its also the implementation in over Indian Railways. I request the participants who have joined this platform and who are listening to this to the lecture to raise their queries or any doubts or questions if they have. This stage is open, so please, I request the participants to come forward with some questions.
Sir Bhadra, can I?
Yes, sir.
Ask
yes,
a question.
Yes,
sir. Good afternoon, sir. I am K. Raman. I am working as a chief workshop engineer in rail wheel factory Yalahanka. Thank you very much, sir. It was a very enlightening lecture, and a lot of questions we had on the subject you have clarified very nicely in the available time. We are most grateful to you. Sir, I have a few observations where I would request your response to the subject, sir. And then maybe if time permits, after some time, I have some few questions also, sir. Sir, on this issue of what you had said, actually, I like that a lot, that hard work at the shop floor level, you had emphasized on it, sir.
Yes.
Actually, what I want to say is something related to that, that whatever systems we are talking about, like the example given of reducing the sidewall cycle time, many of the inputs can come through the conventional subject of manufacturing principles or manufacturing systems design and analysis.
Yes.
So Industry 4 really is a later development, but these topics or these subjects were already well developed and mature subjects.
Yes.
In the sense of either at the process level, you look at process improvement and optimization, or at the manufacturing system level, where it is system design and optimization, or it is at the supply chain level also. So my observation is, sir, that should not the railways, and with your experience of railway factories, what you have seen, first focus on these core subjects of manufacturing systems and then think of Industry 4 rather than directly jumping into this level, sir?
Yes, you are very correct that scheduling per se does not constitute Industry 4.0. It does not constitute Industry 4.0. Industry 4.0 is has to, when you utter the word Industry 4.0, it has to be Internet of Things, where machines are connected to each other, where monitoring is done real time, and also scheduling is done real time. In the various railway production units, we are at different stages of whether it is Industry 2.0, Industry 3.0, partly bits and pieces of Industry 4.0. So we have a potpourri of various situations, but it is also not essential that you have to necessarily go through these steps in a sequential manner, that you first do this and then do that, because with the technology that is available today, scheduling also has to be done with a different kind of protocol. We have to do it in a manner such that it is compatible with the real-time data that is coming, that is accessible through the machines. It has to be done in an integrated manner, which need not necessarily be sequential, but ultimately ultimate decision has to be taken by you. We because history also progresses in leaps and bounds, not in a step-by-step gradual manner. So I would argue, while definitely agreeing with your case, that scheduling as such or optimization as such is not Industry 4.0. The algorithms and the technology, the understanding is all, but to do it in an internet way of things, to make it data-based, which is what is happening in the rest of the world, whether we like it or not, this is going to come. The only question is whether we decide to be a part of it or we decide to be a bystander in Industry 4.0 development. I think we should have a finger in that pie, our own finger in that pie.
Sir, may I interrupt? Ajay Nandan, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In on observation of Raman, it is very correct that these systems are there. The idea of Industry 4.0 is not to go back to the same drawing board, but to develop a process which automates the scheduling and the monitoring and all the functions that we have been so far doing manually or individually, and giving the thought. What we are doing is trying to build a system which is autonomous in itself and is able to take a decision by itself. So kind of where the machine learning part comes. So here are some junior scale officers.
Just one statement. And the country has capability in all these domains, the country, and within your own system, you have people who do sensors, you have people who do data acquisition, you have people who are aware of analytics, you have people, you do have the people. We have the wherewithal and the infrastructure and the human resources in the country to do this. Why wait for it to do it in a sequential manner when the whole thing can be done in an integrated manner?
So here are some junior, fresh officers who have been recently posted on railways who have some questions to ask.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Kshitij Ansikar and I've recently been posted. This is my first posting currently in Indian Railways. Sir, you have talked about all the automation process that we are currently being tried out at MCF. Sir, we are the end users of all the cumulative changes and automations that MCF, RCF, ICF does. If we go to a particular coaching depot, we have coaches that are being manufactured in all three production units. And sir, we find that there are some minor differences. I want to say if there are some changes in the design, after using, we have found that there are some changes that, if there is a feedback mechanism, how quickly can Industry 4.0 or whatever you are, the project that you are doing in MCF, how quickly can it cope up with the changes if a change comes from the zonal railways as such?
The effort is driven towards that. Effort is driven towards that so that it is sensitive to the design changes. Because as you had seen in one of the slides, that it starts with the PSL that is coming out of the design software, the UX, Unigraphics software that you have at ICF and also MCF. So the feedback definitely goes back to the
Sir, I think you're muted.
Yes, sir. Your mic has been muted, sir.
Sir, your mic has been muted, sir.
Oh, so a lot of golden. What I'm saying is that that is the intention, that it has to be sensitive to the changes in changes and alterations in the design. But are we at that stage at the moment? No. I'll be able to answer that more positively after about a year. After about a year into this development. Not yet.
Thank you, sir.
Are there any other, I think perhaps we may have a few more questions from our participants.
Can I ask another question?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you had also mentioned about the add-ons for the machines, which the OEMs are not sharing. For example, Fonuc does not share what are the add-ons and how to exploit them. And actually, it is a very paradoxical situation, sir, because we don't know what is there, so we don't ask. And since we don't ask, we don't know what is there. So it's a very circular type of situation, sir. So I definitely am of the same view, sir, that we have to develop this in-house with our own capability, because this will take care of such issues. So my point in that is, sir, that one project IIT Kanpur is doing with MCF, sir. So how is it planned to roll out to other systems, or is it that we will first complete this project and then roll it out, or certain stages can we share with other units where some preliminary work can be started parallelly?
See, this itself is a lot of work for an academic institution. The information and technology is all of it can be shared with everyone, and we don't in academic institutions, and my team also does not claim any copyright on this. It all belongs to you, and it belongs to the nation, and we also don't do it for any kind of financial remuneration and consultancy. This technology can be shared, platforms can be shared, whatever experience that has been obtained from this can be shared, but the initiative, and it will bear fruit only when people like you, youngsters like you, who take it upon themselves to come abreast with the technology and adopt it and modify it, and you yourself start implementing these things, then that would bring about the real transformation. We are always there to support your work with whatever capabilities that we have. But ultimately, it is to be pilot projects can be taken up at DLW Varanasi, at ICF, and at Perambur, and also the wheels and axles factory. But it has to be done by you. The drive has to come from you, and you should be able to support this and nurture this activity. We always did.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for taking time off out of your busy schedule to address us all on this very important issue, which I can call a burning issue or the trending issue, Industry 4.0, and especially from the Indian Railways point of view, it is very, very important. So, sir, in order to give the closing address, I would request Senior Professor WMP, the Dean Irmi Ajana, to kindly address the gathering, sir, please.
Respected Dr. Vyas and my colleagues from all General Railways, the trainees and faculty members from IRMI, and all those who are attending this lecture. Sir, this has been a great eye-opener for all of us to know about the new and path-breaking project of Industry 4.0. And you have shared with us all the details. Sir, one point I wanted to make was that Mr. K. Raman, who had been making questions with you, he is the chief workshop engineer of Rail Wheel Factory Bangalore. And he actually is the kind of shop owner of the axle plant of the Bangalore, which runs a large number of different technology, CNC, NC, and other type of control machines. And that's why he has a particularly keen interest. So I'm sure he would be taking up your invitation to pursue the, you have addressed all the mechanical engineering officers all across the country, something like about 80 or 90 officers from all over the Indian Railways have joined the lecture, other than the 50-60 of us who are present here at IRMI, for taking the effort as well as sparing the research on this area. It was...
Hello.